Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. Hi, I'm Cheryl Reynolds with the UC Statewide IPM Program. Welcome to today's UC Ag Expert Talk on invasive shot hole borers and avocado. Peter Cassina will be running our polls and troubleshooting technical problems. Both Peter and I are working from our homes, and so it might affect audio a little bit, but hopefully we'll be okay today. And please note that the webinar is targeted to growers and pest management professionals. Master gardeners can certainly benefit from participating, but the pest management methods presented, especially the pesticides, are not to be followed without a clear understanding of their legal use by homeowners. And also, we want to say a special thank you to the Citrus Research Board for their support of this webinar series. Okay, so at this point, we would like to introduce our speaker. Today, we have Dr. Akif Eskalen, who is a plant pathologist and cooperative extension specialist at UC Davis. And today he'll be speaking on invasive shot hole borers and avocado. So now we will pass this over to Akif. So you can go ahead and share your slides.
Thank you, Cheryl, for the introduction. Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. So today I'm going to talk to you about invasive shot hole borers and fusarium dieback, which is their disease, on avocado. So today in my talk, I will be focusing on mostly avocado, but not on the native vegetation plants. If you have question on that, please feel free to write your question in the chat box. So before I start working on my talk, I would like to introduce you my collaborators or co-authors on this study. Shannon Lynch and Gregory Gilbert are from University of California, Santa Cruz, who has been doing the most of the work on this project. Joseph Carrillo and Joy Mayorquin are my former PhD students. Dr. Richard Southhammer is entomologist from UC Riverside. Ben Faber is University of California Cooperative Extension Farm Advisor in Ventura and Santa Barbara counties. Without his help, we wouldn't be able to get any of these the work done. So I just wanted to thank to them before my talk, and then now let's start it. So for those of you who don't know what the prolific shot hole borer or crochet shot hole borer or fusarium dieback is, I would like to give you a brief introduction so you can fresh your memories about it. These shot hole borers are two different ambrosia beetles that has invaded California. One of them is prolific shot hole borer, other one is crochet shot hole borer. They both are separate invasion from Southeast Asia, which I'm gonna talk to you about it a little bit. As an ambrosia beetle, these beetles are associated with more than one fungal species where they can carry them in their mouth in a special organ. It's called mycangia. Those organs have the two different chambers where they can carry the fungal spores in their mouth. So that's very characteristic for the ambrosia beetle. There are other ambrosia beetles also carry their own fungal species. So why do they carry these fungi? We are gonna talk about it in the next slide. So prolific shot hole borer that we know that they are associated with the three different fungi, crochet shot hole borer are associated with the two different fungi. At first, we identified that these fungi are species specific. Later on, a study that has been done with my former PhD student is that we found out that actually they can swap these fungi if they are available in the area, so they can carry and then transmit those fungi from one tree to another tree. So with that, we have five different fungal species associated with these two ambrosia beetles in California. Yeah, I think we have a question here. How many fungi are associated with this beetle? A is more than one, B is only one. So, as I mentioned before, that these beetles are native to Southeast Asia. They are close related species to tea shot hole borer, which is another Eulacea species. As you can see in this area, so those are the areas that the three of these species, Eulacea species, that has been naturally occur in this area. When you look at the distribution of the prolific shot hole borer in this orange color, it has been found not only in California, it also showed up first in Israel, and now it has been invaded in South Africa. Recently, we identified the prolific shot hole borer in a big island of Hawaii on macadamia. So we still don't know how much damage that they cause on macadamia. So we have our collaborators in Hawaii. They are now investigating how much the damage that will cause on macadamia in Hawaii. When we look at the crochet shot hole borer, it has been found in Southeast Asia and also just appear in Southern California, which seems to be a species a little bit more aggressive than a prolific shot hole borer, but we are not gonna go to talk more about it. So we have another question here. So where is these beetles are native to? Mediterranean or Southeast Asia? As I mentioned before, just to check if you are paying attention what we are saying here.
Okay, the results should be showing.
Yes, the answer is Southeast Asia. In here, I would like to talk to you about a little bit life cycle of these pest and disease complex. Unless when you look at the distribution map, which is all over the Southern California right now. So when we first identified this pest and disease complex on the backyard avocado trees, since then we have been the monitoring and tracking these beetles to see what other host species that have been going after, because we know that the close related species, tea shot hole borer, has wide host range. That gives us idea that this could be the way of tea shot hole borers is having the big or large the number of the host. So unlike other bark beetles, this ambrosia beetle seems to be attacking the healthy looking plants or woody trees, I would say. So they usually attack on the branches, in some cases on the trunk. So they make the galleries in the active xylem area, which is 3 to 4 inch deep into the wood. As soon as they get in, they branch it out. In the meantime, when they are making those galleries, they inoculate the wall of the gallery with the fungal species that they have been carrying in their mouth. At the end of the galleries, they lay their eggs and then wait for offsprings to come up. Here is another picture in a one gallery that you can see the young adult, which is right brown color. The adult female is the dark brown or dark black color. So in here you can see the male, which is smaller than the female and then a little bit brownish color. And then you see here is the larvae and pupae. So in here, basically you see a family picture of the ambrosia beetle here. So as soon as the new offsprings become adult, they leave their host to look for their own the places. Mostly they stay in the same tree or same actually location where the initial infestation was made. It's very important for identification of how much damage this beetle could cause to look at the cluster of the infestation, one part of the plant, which I'm gonna talk about. So in here, you can see the fungal species are also pathogenic to the woody plants. the pathogenicity level is a little bit different than the other non-aggressive pathogen, which I'm going to talk to you about it. And then that causes this kind of wilt on very susceptible host. In some hosts, they don't cause any damage. In some hosts, like the box elder, as you can see in this picture, they could cause the wilt. I don't think at this moment that we have any box elder tree species left in Southern California where this beetle is infested already. When their host dies, so most of the beetle are leave the galleries, look for the new, the healthy looking, the vigorous plants where they can start initiate their fungal combination or galleries in that plant. So we have another question in here. Where does the beetle carry their associated fungi? Is it in their mouth or it is in their abdomen, which is back of the beetle? Okay, so the answer is that there is a special the organ in their mouth, which is called the mycangia, where they can carry. They can carry some of the fungal species on abdomen by contamination outside, but intentionally, the organ that they carry is in their mouth. So when we look at the beetle life cycle, so that's very interesting life cycle of the beetle. Sex ratio of the offsprings are female bias, which means the female can decide how many female offsprings that she would like to produce and how many male she would like to produce. It's very interesting and amazing ability to do that. Brothers mate with the sisters in the galleries. So that makes that these beetles are not being exposed to the outsiders, just in case if there's a natural enemies. So they mate within the galleries to reduce the risk of being exposed to the outsiders, which is very interesting and an amazing way of survival, the way of doing it. So mated females leave the galleries, and then they would like to create their own galleries, as I mentioned, within the plants, and then although they can go to the outside also too. So female of these beetles can fly, but male can stay in the galleries because they are flightless. They can walk outside of the galleries time to time to look for the opportunistic mating, but they usually stay in the galleries. So when it comes to attack location of each plant is very important for these beetles, to the amount of the damage that they will cause. For example, in some host species, such as sycamore, the box elder, willow, and some other tree species, they attack starting from the main trunk and also branches, as you can see here. Each one of them is the one single gallery of the beetle. When it comes to avocado or some other tree species, they only colonize on the branches. Based on the where they are able to attack and colonize, the damage that they cause is gonna be the different that I'm gonna a little bit explain more about. When it comes to young plants, such as in this picture in avocado, they don't attack or colonize at all. Not only avocado or many other tree species that are susceptible for this beetle attack, they are somehow are not able to, or they don't like to attack young part of the plant. As I mentioned that I'm gonna focus on the avocado attack or colonization of this beetle, that in here you see the two different the avocado trees, and then in this the circle that I'm showing you that these are the location of the beetle that they usually colonize on the branches or sometimes branch color where the branch is separating from the main trunk. These are the areas that we see. That could cause branch dieback, as you can see on this left picture, or sometime. And that little bit depends on what kind of branch that they colonize, that branch dieback could be bigger branch or smaller branch that we are gonna talk about. So that could cause the branch dieback on not only avocado, some other tree species as well. When the colonization of the beetle is so intense in one location, that branch could be breakdown because of the compromisation of the extensive beetle galleries that's being accumulated right here. So the colony of the beetle in certain areas is very important. That could cause the mechanical damage. Interestingly, there's another branch just coming out of this branch, which is younger than this branch. You don't see any attack. So that's where the severity or amount of the damage that would cause is coming out. So in avocado, it looks like it can only colonize and attack older branches, even though there's a branch infested here, they don't go after the younger branches. How do I know that this is younger branches? Because of the color of the bark. The younger branch has a lighter bark, and then the older one is the darker bark. When you look at the infested avocado orchard, you can also see attack on the main trunk, as I showed you before on the sycamore. But when you look at these attack, we call it a beetle attack attempt, which means you can see the beetle attack on the main trunk. When you peel the bark, you cannot see any the continuous bark or galleries. That means beetle try to attack on avocado main trunk, but they are not able to establish any galleries. When you go a little bit deeper, they are not even able to establish their fungal pathogens within that. Why this is happening? At this moment, as part of Shannon Lynch, the project, she is looking at microbiome content of between the trunk and then the branch part of the plant to see if there is some microbiome within the tissues that is not allowing the beetle to introduce their fungi, or if there is another chemical effect or aspect of it. It's very interesting. Same tree, they cannot colonize on the trunk, but they can colonize on the branches. It could be also how bigger that part of the plant is the playing role too. So we are not going to go on that part, that detail, but that's something that we are currently working on. Black streak disease is another disease of the avocado that caused by group of the fungal pathogens, which are Bortosperia group of the pathogens, the very common one, as you can see. So you can see like the darker or some of the sugar exudate, the kind of structure, which is very common, the symptom of the avocado that's being infested by the beetle. When you look at the under the bark, you can see the darker discolored area of the tissue, which we were able to identify several different Bortosperia group of the fungi that is causing this kind of symptom. I'm trying to show you these pictures that it's very common that could be confused by black streak or other diseases that could look like the Pelophagus shuttle borer or Crochia shuttle borer. In our case, we also saw or found often the beetles prefer to attack these compromised and previously attack or a fungal colonized area of the plant, which I'm going to talk to you about it a little later. As you all know, that the high density planting is getting common and common on avocado orchards. So there are a few avocado orchards that we have been monitoring in California have high density planting. This is the one avocado tree in Azusa area, north part of the Los Angeles area. So as you can see that in the high density planting, where there are more shade, you can see more branch dieback or colonization of the beetle in the lower, smaller branches of the plant. So this is the close-up picture of one of those small branches that you can see the colonization right here. So the Pelophagus and Crochia shuttle borers have wide host range, like similar One, that the T-shot hole borer that we don't have in California, which is the very close related species of the Polyphagus and Croatia shot hole borer. So since 2012, since when we first identified these beetles on a backyard avocado trees, and then since then we have been tracking down how many other tree species that are being host in California. In 2012, we identified and found out that the more than 283 species are being attacked, or we found the evidence of attack of these beetles on these tree species. So we were able to recover the fungal species from out of the 117 tree species. That was the one number of concern of it. So the 13 of them were agricultural crop, avocado was one of them, and 11 of them were the California native plants and then different families. In 2019, this number increased dramatically. But when we look at the damage that they are causing in each host is specific and unique. For example, in agricultural crop, we found that they are able to attack 14 different agricultural crop, but only on avocado, the beetle is able to colonize or produce offsprings on the branches, which is not causing that much damage. But when you look at the other plants, you can find attack, but they are not causing that much damage on the plant. Actually, in none of these agriculture plants, we have seen any dead plant caused by the only combination of the Polyphagus and Croatia shot hole borer and also fusarium dieback. That's, I need to tell you that. When it comes to native tree species in California, that's a different situation. So most of the native tree species are susceptible and they are vulnerable and they cannot handle attack by these beetle and their fungi, which I'm not gonna go that far, but what I wanna mention here is that the California box elder is the one of the native tree species in California. So that's the most susceptible tree species, which is now the disappeared from Southern California, the landscape. So these numbers are increasing and then it's coming out. So are they susceptible to cause some damage? This is the information that we came up with the amount of the information that we have collected so far since 2012 when we first identified about this beetle, is that now we are able to separate susceptible host that may cause the tree death, which most of them are Acer and some of the Populus, Quercus, and some of the Salix species. Those are the three species that could die because of the infestation of this beetle and their fungi. There are about 53 species that beetle and fungi could attack branches and certain parts of the plants, but they didn't cause any death of the trees. So these are the number of the tree species. Those three species can be found on ISHB.org website. Avocado is one of them. It's the one that only beetle can only colonize and attack on the branches. I also mentioned here that so not only branches, they usually attack or colonize the canker disease margin, which we are gonna talk about. I think we have another question here. So question is, how many tree species are reproductive hosts for this beetle? All of the woody trees, as an A, between 60 to 80 tree species.
And real quickly, while they're answering this, just a quick comment. Somebody just had a question. What does the asterisk mean in your previous slide?
Oh, those are the native to California. Sorry, I forgot to mention that. Question is between 60 to 80 at this point, at this moment. But as I mentioned that these number of the tree species are increasing because sometimes I get the questions that, so what is next? How many, what kind of damage that this beetle could cause yet you think? As an invasive pest, as I always give this answer, that even beetle doesn't know how much damage that they are gonna cause, because even for the beetle, this is as a new land, new climate, and new host species that they haven't been probably experienced finding in where they are native to. So therefore, they are moving one tree to another tree. If I have to give you an example, that when we first start working on this pest, we found most of the box elder are being reproductive host. And later on, we start seeing one or two attack on sycamores. At that time, we even questioned, oh, is the sycamore trees are susceptible or attack? We didn't even believe that could be a reproductive host. Within a short time, most of the sycamore trees became reproductive host this beetle. So when they are running out of the most susceptible host, they can move to the other host species that they prefer less, but doesn't matter, they colonize and then they could cause damage on other species. So if I have to give you the historical distribution spread of this beetle, is that this beetle was first detected in 2003 in a CDFA trap by accident, and then it was identified morphologically as a T-shot hole borer. And then beetle became quiet for several years. In 2012, we found this beetle on a backyard avocado trees. That everything started from there. That was the big concern, because we found that this beetle on avocado, because California is one of the number one avocado producing the state in the United States. And then we were very concerned that could cause more damage. The another reason is that there's another Ambrosia beetle pest disease complex, which is called laurelwilt in East Coast, that is causing a lot of damage with the pathogen that is very, very, very more aggressive than fungal species that's being carried by the shuttle borers. But at that time, so we didn't know how much damage these beetles would cause on one of the agricultural crops at that time. In 2013, this is the Southern California, here is the Los Angeles, and then beetles start spreading, which is the red color is the prolific shuttle borer. In 2014, we found another a separate invasion. At first, we thought that this is the same beetle that just starts spreading from California, Los Angeles to the San Diego. Indeed, the Dr. Stadthammer has done some molecular identification, and he found out that this is the different beetle. Now it's calling Corocia shuttle borer than the prolific shuttle borer. They are kind of cousins, very close related species. Both of them are the Eulacea species. The damage that they cause, similar. In 2014, 2016, it moved to the Tijuana River Valley, that was like the 2015. So it's actually crossed the border. Now it has been found in border of the Mexico as well. In the meantime, start moving to the north. And then in 2017, we start seeing the infestation on avocado orchards in Ventura County. If I had to give you a little bit information about the where the avocado grows are, is that almost 50% of the avocado grows are in Southern California in San Diego counties. Other 50% of it is Ventura and Santa Barbara and a little bit on San Luis Obispo area. So these are the two major avocado growing areas that we had concern of having damaged or infested by these beetles at that time. So in 2019, this is the infestation. All these yellows are at that time we were monitoring by the trapping of these beetles to see how widespread it is. So these are the color that shows you the possible infested areas of the beetle. One or two beetles that has been found in San Luis Obispo area, but we haven't seen any the damage on any of the tree species in that area. So these are the current infested areas of the beetle. So we have another question here. Which part of the California is infested with this beetle and then dieback so far? Question A is Southern California. Question B is Northern California. Yes, the answer is Southern California. So it's slowly moving to the Northern California, but we don't have any infestation level. So most importantly, the beetle hasn't been show up in our major agriculture, the crop area, which is the Central Valley yet, which I'm not gonna make comment on that one. So it hasn't been moved that far yet. It's only in the Southern California part. So when we first identified this beetle on avocado, that was our main concern with the funding that was provided by California Avocado Commission and avocado growers in California. We come up with a project to address. First, we wanted to come up with a quick real-time PCR assay where we can identify the beetle within a short time quickly. We also wanted to determine rate of the spread of the both beetles within the avocado trees, between the avocado groves, and within the avocado orchards, which was very important for us. That will give us an idea how much damage these beetles could potentially cause on avocados. We also wanted to identify the potential environmental factors. The reason for that, even though in Southern California seems to be a certain one climate, but there are a lot of microclimate where these beetles could prefer better than other places. When you look at the where these beetles coming are from, they are from, they're native to Southeast Asia, mostly tropical climate, high humidity, moisture, and then high heat area. We also wanted to address that area. At the end, we would like to come up with the management strategies to control these beetles, not only in avocado orchards, but also in native vegetation as well. For the frog-based real-time PCR work, my graduate student, Joseph Carrillo, has done work, and then we are able to identify the beetle right now with the quick-time PCR from pure culture of the fungal associate, from the infested or discolored symptomatic wood pieces, or from the fungal species of the mouth of the beetle directly. Because the reason is that when we identify these fungal species, which are species specific, we can identify what beetle is infested in that area. If you are interested in knowing more about this study has been published that could be found online. If you would like to know more about it, I can send you the copy of it. Please send me an email about it. This is the melting curve that shows you that we can identify the DNA from the pure culture, from the woody tissues, and also from the mycangel fungal associates of the beetle. Our second and third objective is to determine the rate of the spread of the prolific shuttle borer and crochet shuttle borer in avocado orchards to get an idea how much damage these beetles could cause. In order to do that, so we come up with 1 hectare, 3/3 by 3/3 feet square, the monitoring plots that we call it permanent monitoring plots in infested and non-infested avocado orchards next to the infested avocado orchards. Our goal was to find out, to mark every single trees, evaluate them, and then find out how much damage that they cause, and then come up within every 3 months or so to see how much spread of the beetle or damage that could cause. In each plot, we put weather station and also trap. Not only look for the visual inspection of the beetle, but also we wanted to trap or find out how many beetles in the air or in the area of that area to find out. In each plot, we monitored every single tree that we marked, look for the overall health, overall beetle severity, or also attack severity by the plant part, because we wanted to know, as I mentioned, that if the beetle attacking the main trunk is different than the branches, we also wanted to come up with that one idea. And also we wanted to record other pathogens which are contributing to the dieback or attack of these beetles in orchards. In 2015, we initially set up 19 avocado groves, which most of them were in Escondido area, where the most of the avocado groves are in San Diego County. And also we found a couple other avocado groves in Orange County, which is not common, but we were able to find a couple of small orchards that we wanted to know the severity of the beetle infestation in that area as well. In 2017, we received additional funding from California Avocado Commission and also California Specialty Crop Grant funding that we gathered additional. And then we added 41 additional plots to monitor in those plots because we wanted the beetle spreading along the time, and we wanted to follow up to see how much damage that they will cause when they come to the new location. Not only avocado groves, we also established total 265 plots in native vegetation near avocado orchards because we wanted to know if the beetle is coming back and forth between these areas. So this is the picture that shows the number of the plots in Ventura counties. Here is the picture that shows the total 300 the plots, permanent plots that we have been monitoring since 2015 in Southern California. So here's the results that we come up with after first 3 years on avocado orchards. This is the incidence of the beetle attack in avocado orchards. So these are the San Diego, these are the Ventura counties. The green color shows the 2017. The black color shows the 2018. Within a year, as you can see, the new colonization or the attack of the beetle is less than the year before. That was encouraging for us to see the beetle attack is less than year before. And then these numbers go year after the lower and year after lower. The reason for that, at that time when we identified that these beetles are attacking the branches of the avocado, and then one of the best management practices that we first initiated that they remove those infested branches. That was the first initiation. Because avocados, orchards are manageable, and every year farmers do the pruning, and then they were able to remove those infested branches every year pruning, and then that way the new infestation level went down every year. So this is also showing us that the in avocado orchards, the beetle colonization is not a big concern in terms of the number of the attacks on the new colonies. So the preliminary results from these studies has been published from the Grow magazine. That's a part of the California Avocado Commission magazines that can be found in our website online if you are interested in knowing more about it. During the survey, the most important part was what part of the avocado is most susceptible. When we look at the initial part of the attack, we haven't seen any colonization of this beetle on the trunk, which is the good news. That means avocado is not subject to death, because we know that when the beetle attacked the colonized on the main trunk, that caused more damage than anywhere else. When you look at the primary branches and secondary branches, that level of the infestation also very low. The only attack, a high concentration of the attack that we found in tertiary branches, which is not a big deal in avocado orchards. Avocado growers know that the avocado trees is very vigor tree. It's originally from the tropical, subtropical area. So they grow faster than any other plants. So therefore, when their tertiary branches are being damaged by the disease beetles, they are able to recover quickly and then move on that one. So we also found some of the twigs, but very small part of the branch of the avocado, but it looks like it is not a big the concern or damage of the avocado. So this is the one that is showing us the these combination of the beetles and their fungi is a not big deal on avocado orchards in California. Here's the number of the beetle that we trap between the each different the plot of the avocado areas that we had. As you can see, over the time, you don't see new infestation on the non-infested areas. They are not moving that fast. When it comes to the same orchard that is infested, if that orchard is not being managed by removing those infested branches, you can see the beetle population is increasing every year because beetles are able to produce in these areas. As long as the farmers are doing removing those infested branches, they are able to manage the colonization or damage of these beetles on avocado orchards. So as a part of our study, we also wanted to identify if any of the avocado cultivars are less or more susceptible. We all know that most of the avocados today grow in California is a Hass, I would say 90%. And then she also wanted to add that if other the species are susceptible to the fungal species, not talking about the beetle. When we artificially inoculated these fungal associates on the young plant, they can show this kind of sugar exudate, which is the tree response from the wound that's causing, but they don't do that much damage. That shows us these fungal associates of the beetle are not aggressive pathogen on avocado and other tree species, comparing with other ambrosia beetle, which is known as a laurel wilt disease in eastern part of the United States, which is a single the inoculation of the fungi in one tree. It takes a couple of weeks, maybe less than a couple of weeks, the entire tree could die. So that's also giving us an idea when the beetle could cause damage on a tree, it is fungal associated is not the one that's gonna cause damage individually, but multiple attack of the beetle will cause the damage because they are causing mechanical damage and also introducing more localized fungal species that causing the local pathogenicity in that area. So this is the one of the drone picture that I wanted to share with you is that to show you that the landscape of common avocado orchard in Southern California. And here you see the San Luis Rey, which is full of native plants, including willow, cottonwood, maybe box elder, all kinds of suitable hosts. And here you see the hillside and avocado orchard. So we now know that this beetle could colonize on native tree species. So therefore, if your avocado orchard is close to native vegetation, the beetle could come from heavily infested that vegetation to the avocado orchards or this area. So that is giving you an idea about the landscape issues. So when you look at the infestation of the beetle, you are not only looking for the one crop or one area. You got to look at the entire ecosystem to see how many other suitable species that could be hosting these beetles. As a conclusion, from our monitoring and experimental results show that the shuttle borer and their fungi are causing less damage to avocado trees compared with the other hosts, such as native tree vegetation, box elders, sycamores, and willows. I would like to say the not causing damage, but I cannot say it because if the orchard is not managed very well, you can still see attack or colonization on the branches, especially on the dead branches area of the plant. But is it causing the economical damage? So far, as I mentioned that the avocado is so bigger, we haven't recorded any economical damage that could cause by shot hole borer complex on avocados in California. This beetle seems to prefer only branches, in particular the tertiary branches on avocado. That's why the damage that caused by the beetle is very less. Removal of the infested branches is very, very important. As these beetles first show up in avocado orchards, we see more damage than anywhere else at first. Why? Because at that time, there were more available dead branches or branches that has the canker disease where beetle prefer to colonize more than anywhere else. So the management is very key point to get the less damage from these beetles in avocado orchards. So that's a part of the last part of the objective was to provide the management guidelines. So what kind of management that we are coming from? Before we come on to the talk about the management strategies, I would like to talk to you about the wood canker pathogens that contributes to the beetle colonization on not only on avocado, but also other tree species. Here's one avocado, and then as you can see, this is the old pruning wounds. You can see the discoloration right there. These are mainly colonized by the group of the pathogen. It's called Botrys ferriaceae, and then they can cause the canker. Why is this important? Avocado black streak that I also talked to you about it, also caused by the group of these pathogens. Not only one, and then multiple pathogens. These black streak used to be attributed to could be a viral disease, but we identified that the group of the fungal diseases in that one. We have a question here. So what causes black streak disease of avocado? The options are fungal canker pathogens, B is the virus. Yes, most of them the canker pathogens, and so far we haven't seen any virus is associated with this one, and but we are able to identify the pathogens, not only identify, we also set up a pathogenicity test on the plants, and then we were able to also to see or come up with the same the symptoms that we have been seeing on black streak on avocado. In one of the early studies that we have done in 2013, we were able to identify how spread these canker pathogens in California to show you that most of the avocado growing areas, not only avocado growing areas, but I will say these canker pathogens also could show up on other wood tree species as well. So that means, so the beetle would find more opportunity to be able to colonize on the part of the plant that's contaminated or infested by these pathogens. Here, a prolific shot hole borer scanning electron microscopic picture. It's a very close up picture. As you can see here, these are the hair naturally occurs on the beetle. All these are the fungi. So beetle not only carry their fungus in their mouth, but also the contamination, they could carry and contaminate those other fungi. Not only fusarium, but also Botrys ferriaceae group of the fungi that are more aggressive than the associated fungi of the beetle. We have a question here. Can beetle carry other pathogenic fungi? Yes or no? Okay, the answer is yes. Maybe not intentionally. None of the Botrys ferriaceae group of the fungi has been found in their mouth, Meckenzia, but by contamination, yes. Here's a good example of the branch canker and black streak where the beetle colonization is so most. We think that the beetle prefers margin of these canker area where they can find less response from the plant. They don't wanna colonize entire dark, that part, because in that part, there is no moisture where they can grow their fungi. Those fungi that beetle are feeding on. And then these are the good example of it. So these in the avocado orchard, as long as you have these kind of canker pathogens, you will see that areas are more colonized by these beetles. For the avocado growers, I would recommend look for the symptoms on the old dead branches. As you can see, this is the old pruning wounds. You will see the sugar exudate, which is the tree response. When you peel the bark, it's very interesting, especially that you will see in the canker margin, that's the area that you will see the beetle colonization. But just wanna pay attention that the living tissue right there, you don't see any new infestation. They just like that margin area. Same as here, this is too dry that you cannot see any infestation. So we have a question in here. Is it important to remove dead branches from a tree? The answer is yes, the beetle prefers margin of the dead wood. The B is no, it is not important. Okay, yes, the beetle prefers margin of dead wood. So sometimes, as I mentioned, that this canker pathogen could cause more damage than any other thing. So it's very important. So here's the black streak, which is very, very, very common. So that's just wanted to show you the difference between that. So we have another question here. How does the beetle spread? Fly, bees, infested wood, or both? Okay, both. Yes, beetle fly, which is true, and also beetle can transmitted or transferred by the infested wood, including firewood. And in that case, answer is both. From our monitoring or survey studies, we knew that the pruning wound areas are the most vulnerable areas to protect the new infestation of these beetles. Because of that, we set up a kind of management options to control these beetles on the pruning wounds. So in one of the studies that we have done in vitro and field trial, we tried several different fungicides that are registered currently on avocado. And also we tried some of the biocontrol agents, including Bacillus subtilis, which we found out that in vitro condition, that's the perfect, the controlling mechanism of the, not only chateau borer associated fungi, but also Bortusferia group of the fungi. And also Borrelia bassiana, which is the another entomopathogen fungi. Okay, from the results from that study, that this is the one that shows the mean total offsprings, number of offsprings that shows this is the control. These are the azoxystrobilin, which still controls it at a little bit effect. Bifenthrin is the one that controls 100%. Bulwaria bassiana is working very well. They cannot colonize this. Bacillus subtilis is not bad. And then also thiabendazole seems to be working well, but this is not registered to use on avocado. I believe bifenthrin used to be registered as a section 18 for a short time, but it's not the registered at this moment. The only Bacillus subtilis could be applied as a foliar application on avocado. So this is my last part of the slide that I would like to go through the what to do and infested the avocado orchards. As I mentioned that I'm focusing on avocado growth. You have to inspect the branches, especially the branch color, because as I mentioned that they think about that this is a tree, this is the branch, this is the branch color. This is the area is the most vulnerable and also most susceptible that beetle prefers attacking and colonization of the things. So this is an example of old pruning wounds is the perfect place to look for. Here's a very important part. Sometimes when the beetle attacks, when you don't see the cluster of the attack, don't worry about it to remove these branches. Because unless you see a colonization of the attack like that, which means beetle established galleries and they are producing offsprings in that area comparing with this picture, okay? So In this case, you don't need to remove these branches, which is a big branch that could cause damage, that you can lose some the crop on that branches. So you only need to remove these branches. When you remove the branches, which the normal pruning, the management practices, when you remove here, you can still have some infested areas on the branch collar, which is not a common practice for us to remove the branches when we are pruning avocados. But in this case, if the infestation is that you cannot remove, we recommend you to remove entire branch collar, as you can see here. So this is the special recommendation that we are making, is that the remove entire branch collar and that area. So I'm gonna show you another video that how you do that. In this case, today, the only Bacillus subtilis, which is the serenade ASO, is the one that's registered to apply as a foliar. So that could be applied to prevent the not only colonization of the pulpific shuttle borer and crochet shuttle borer, but also other Botrysophila group of the canker pathogens. We have gotten a good results from that. And don't move infested plant material. So those are the ones that could move from one location to another location, which is very, very important. Now we have a question in here. Are there any pesticide options to protect pruning wounds from the beetle colonization on avocado? The answer is A is yes, B is no. Yes, so as I mentioned to you that the Bacillus subtilis seems to be still available for you if you have a heavily infested areas, or not only infested, that could also work to protect from the canker pathogens as well. So you are not gonna, this is a kind of win-win situation. In here, I would like to show you a short video to show you how to properly prune not only avocado, but also other wood species. First of all, sterilization of the pruning equipment is very, very important. We recommend you the pruning, even though we found the transmission of the pathogen from these pruning wounds are very low, but still constant. So we call it three cut method. First cut should be the under, a little bit away from the branches, as I can show you here. The reason that we do that, when these branches is heavy, when they break off, you don't want a scar in that area, which plant is gonna have a difficulty to cover. So this is the thing. So this is not your final cut. In your final cut, you are gonna cut in the branch collar area, not removing entire branch collar, unless it is infested, and leaving that kind of thing. The smooth branch surface is gonna make this plant to recover in that area better than anywhere else. If there's no infestation, you don't need to apply anything when you do the proper pruning cut. If you leave longer pruning wound in here, what's happening is that this part of the branch is not getting some carbohydrate from the leaves, which is not exist. Now this branch is dying very quickly. When the branch dies, it's becoming perfect space for the not only Botrysophila or canker pathogens, but also for the beetle colonization. So this way, you are actually preventing not only having the canker, but also beetle colonization in your orchard. So with that, I would like to thank the California Avocado Commission for their support since day one. So they were very dedicated, and with the information that we gathered from this research, now, other commodities and also the native vegetation commodities, I would say, are utilizing those information. I would like to thank to them. I would like to also thank the USDA Farm Bill for supporting the part of our projects. So we were able to get some information for the rest of the community in Southern California or entire California. So with that, if we have time, I will be happy to answer any questions. Or how are we going to do that, Cheryl?
Okay.
Let me read.
So
you are going to read.
Yeah, I'll read them to you. Okay. So You don't have to worry. Okay, so the first one, so if the beetles transfer fungi, would an emerging female take the new fungi to its new gallery?
Okay, so in the galleries where these offsprings are coming out, they feed on the fungal garden that's been established by their parents, by their mother. So they feed on those fungi. By the time they are ready to come out, they are already have their fungal spores loaded in their mycangia, and then they go out. When they are going out, the only things extra that they can carry, some of the protosporia group of the fungi, if it is infested in that branch, by contamination. Otherwise, they don't need to worry about it, because while they are becoming adult, they are feeding those fungi and then filling their mycangia. Okay, second question.
Okay, what is the percent of offspring male versus female?
We have a publication on that one. If you send me an email, I can send you the and that one. So from top of my head, I will say 1 to 5, 1 to 6, because the female female is the one that run the show. That's the one that make the galleries, transfer the fungi, and then do the everything. The male function is only mating. Therefore, female is able to identify or detect how many female that she would prefer having, and then one male for a certain number of the female. So they are very accurate in that one. And then again, I can give you more information that we just published, Dr. Richard Stadtheimer's student just published a paper with my students. You can get more information about that. But from top of my head, less male than female.
Okay, the next one, is fusarium dieback a general term that originated before it was known that there are multiple fungal species, or is it specific to that type of fungus?
That's a very good question. When we first detected this beetle, the fusarium was the only fungi that we were able to detect at that time. And then we call it fusarium dieback. Actually, we actually talked with some of the our collaborators, and then to find out, we also to talk with the collaborators from the Israel. So this beetle first was found in Israel and avocados. And then we also talked to them. We found out that at that time, the fusarium was the only fungi that we knew. Later on, we found additional fungi, graphium and paracrinonium, which we published that one as well. So that name stick with that one.
Okay, next, have people tested organically raised versus non-organically avocado trees or seen any patterns there in terms of resistance?
It's a very good question. We had, but in our monitoring plots, we also had some of the avocado orchards that was organically raised. I have to say that the avocado is the one that doesn't have a lot of pesticides that has been used in California. There are some insecticide that has been used, but that's not that much, but we haven't seen any pattern. The most important part is the how healthy the orchard is, and then how much the orchard is being maintained by the farmers is important.
Okay, next question. So the branches are cut off and then the trunk survives on the avocados when they're infested?
Yes. For example, the beetle, you will see attack on the trunk. They'll try. We call it attack attempt. Try to attack, but they cannot colonize it. So you don't need to worry about on avocado when you see the trunk. So in that case, if you have an orchard, avocado orchard, if you see the branches, that the branch is clustered infestation, as I mentioned that, you don't need to cut every single the hole that you see on the branches. You don't need to go that far. So you just need to make sure that you are removing the infested branches. Okay, yes, the trunk is gonna survive.
Okay, next is, do environmental factors influence which trees are attacked by boar adults? So for example, are trees under stress more susceptible?
As we speak, the Shannon Lynch, who is graduating, finishing her PhD soon, has been analyzing those data that she collected for 5 years of data. And then, yes, I will say from top of my head is that when the tree is compromised, they are more vulnerable. Why? Because it's about like the tree response. When tree is more stressed by the environment and everything, and then they are responding less to the beetle attack. Not only beetle, but also their fungi. It's very, very important. Again, I don't want to go through that one. So soon we are coming up with a publication on that one, so you will get more information. But to answer your question quickly, that's the answer, okay?
Okay, are young avocado or other tree species at greater risk than mature trees?
No, not only on avocado, but also other host species, we haven't seen attack and death or compromisation of the young plants. The plant has to become a certain diameter, and that we have seen so far, 3 or 4 inch, the diameter size of the trunk is being attacked, but they are not always the subject to death, but they are less susceptible. Again, as we speak, right now we are comparing the microbiome between the young trunk or branch or different location based on the environment to see if there is any differences between those areas.
Okay, next one. How was the beetle introduced in Southern California?
We don't know exactly, but we have a guess. The beetle cannot apparently fly from Southeast Asia to here. So what we think is that it probably came with the packing material. But the commercial merchandise. How do we know that? Dr. Richard Southheimer, who is my colleague from UC Riverside, and I, been in the Southeast Asia, and then we have seen a lot of the acacia trees that's being used mostly for the pallets, packing materials. They are all supposed to be treated, which sometimes you can see the stem that was treated, but we don't know if those are really treated or not. So we are guessing that they probably introduced here as a packing material, a wood packing material. Nowadays, I believe those wooden the materials are not allowed to use. I think they are now using the plastic ones.
Okay, what can we do to prevent the beetles from attacking our avocado or sycamore trees?
That's a very good question. But first of all, there's nothing that you can do when the beetle comes. There is no deterrent that you can deter the beetle to come to your either orchard or your the sycamore trees. Again, there are some studies has been done looking for some deterrents. It looks like the some of those available deterrents are not quite working. If you want to make them working, you have to make it like the Christmas tree out of it to work it, which is not sustainable of the way it. So what I will say is that if you are a grower or if you have the sycamore trees that you are wondering about for the infestation is that do the monitoring. You got to check your trees. First of all, have a good agricultural practices, which means when you prune your plants, remove those infested, the canker infested branches of the plant. That way you can reduce the population of the beetle in your area. If you have a less population, you have less the damage that could cause. Those are the ones I would recommend. Keep an eye on it. When you see the infested branches, remove it and immediately to reduce the population in that area. That's what I would say.
Okay. Are there other types of commercial fruit grown in California, such as almonds, that could be damaged by the borer?
A good point. No. We haven't seen any other agricultural commodity has been exposed to this beetle. But we also know that this beetle infestation is only in the Southern California, where most of the agricultural commodities are in the Central Valley and the Northern part of the central wallet. It hasn't been there yet. But we have done laboratory studies, in greenhouse studies, to find out that the one of the almond is the one of the most common crop in California that's being grown. We wanted to find out if the almond is susceptible to the fungal pathogens. What we know is that if a fungal associates of the beetle could colonize and grows without the tree response, beetle could colonize. Why? Beetle is looking for a place to grow their fungus. That's all they are looking for. With collaboration with cooperative extension specialist Florent Troyas from University of California, Davis, UC Kearney, we have done some experiment in the laboratories, found out that the beetle associated fungi could colonize on almond. But we haven't seen any almond tree is attacked or colonized by this beetle at this moment.
Okay. Are trees grown with structured water less susceptible?
Okay. So there are evidence that when the plant is over irrigated, the beetle seems to be prefer those one because they can, the over irrigation could kind of another stress on the plant. And also beetle prefers compromised and also the waterlogged plant where they can grow their fungi. So we haven't done any studies on that one. I believe Dr. Tim Payne from University of California, Riverside, he's one of graduate students, has done some studies, and then he found some association with the over irrigation versus less irrigation. I want to mention another point is that most of the avocado groves in California are infested by another pathogen, which is called avocado root rot, Phytophthora root rot, which is with the Phytophthora cinnamomi, is the very common pathogen on avocado. That also cause compromisation of the avocado orchard as well. Yes, irrigation, other pathogens are very important. How susceptible those trees gonna be?
Okay, what is the percentage of avocado trees that are dying?
Good point. So far, we haven't seen any single avocado died from this beetle. That's very interesting. We were not expecting to see that one, but we haven't seen it. 0%. Have we found a lot of branch dieback? Yes, a lot of them. Are they causing some kind of economical impact? We haven't found any evidence on that one. Not only us, similar studies are also being done by our collaborators, colleagues from Israel on avocados, because Israel is another avocado growing areas. They also haven't seen any evidence or problem that caused economically or mechanically by these beetles on avocados.
Okay. Okay, why did beetles increase in 2018 in San Diego?
Okay, to answer this question that again, we have some data that we are evaluating right now to come up. That could be the intensity of the available host is important. For example, if you have more susceptible host in one location in a high density, beetle is finding more suitable host and then thriving there, producing more population. When the population is so high, they attack any other tree species that are less susceptible. It doesn't matter because population is so high. It's very important to keep the population down. So first of all, we have evidence that the crochet chateau borer seems to be producing more offsprings than the prolific chateau borer because of the environment or temperature that they are into in southern part of the California in San Diego, because it's almost summer all the time. That's the perfect condition. The second one is that the suitable host in southern part of the California, we have more suitable or high dense of the suitable host. So that could be the driving things. Again, I cannot answer specifically 2018. These are the one evidence that we have. Again, as we speak, we are finalizing the our 5 years of monitoring results, and then we are gonna be able to answer your question soon.
Okay, are there similar studies going on in urban tree settings, particularly in San Diego?
Yes, as I mentioned that today, I'm just focusing on the avocado. So as part of the my lab group and then other associate this, we have been monitoring on not only avocados, but also urban forest and native forest, and especially riparian areas in not only San Diego, but also in Orange County and Ventura counties. As I show you the pictures, we have right now over 300 different permanent plants in entire Southern California to get an idea of what's going on in terms of the beetle association. Yes, so I didn't mention you that the, so we have also the support from the SANDAC, San Diego Government of Association in San Diego, and also the LAC grant from the Orange County. So we are all combining and getting a big picture of Southern California very soon.
Okay, where do growers take the infested branches?
Well, we recommend that chip and keep the infested wood in the infested areas. Here's a question. When you chip an infested wood about the 1 or 2 inch size, you control almost 97-98% of the beetle. That study has been done by a group of the researchers in UC Riverside. And when you spread that chip in infested area, that chip is gonna dry up very quickly, and then 2 or 3% infestation in infested area is not that important. So in most of the avocado orchards are on the hillside, it's very difficult to bring all the branches in one area and then solarize them, which is another option that you can solarize. So that's what they do. They chip it as we recommended, and then spread in the orchard wherever it is. That's the recommendation. If you wanted to remove that chipping material to the non-infested areas, we recommend you to solarize them to make sure you are controlling every single beetle in that area. Because without needing of the mating from the male, one single female could establish their own galleries and then produce haploid offsprings of the male, which is her son, and she can mate with her son and then produce fertile female within this next generation. That's the stage. So, which is very important to not to move one single beetle into non-infested areas.
Okay, while removing branches can help reduce populations, how does this impact yields in the short and long term?
In avocado orchards, it doesn't cause that much damage. First of all, as I showed you, my first picture is that on avocado, they usually attack on the old pruning wound. That's the part. They don't attack the younger the branches. As long as you remove the old pruning wounds where the Bortosferia canker are, you are not moving the part of the plant. You are gonna be okay. You are not removing big part of the plant. As I mentioned that in this study, we found out the tertiary branches, trunk, this is the branch, tertiary branches, which is not that important for production. So it's not causing any damage. So as part of the first question, I think I missed the question, is that are pesticides necessary to apply those the chippings? Not necessary. As I mentioned that you don't need to apply a pesticide, because as long as you keep the chipping material in the local infested area, you are gonna be okay.
Okay, so was the removal of many of the infested sycamore trees done as a precaution or misdiagnosis?
Okay, sycamore is different than avocado. As I show you, my first picture is that the beetle attack on the trunk of the sycamore. Therefore, they can populate more and then they kill the sycamore. So in that case, he recommend if the sycamore trees is heavily infested, that you can find information about how to remove infested plant material step by step in a handout that you can find from ISHB.org, that you can see the guidelines of that. So as I mentioned that all these recommendations today I gave you from the avocados, orchards. When it comes to native vegetation, including landscape trees, the sycamore trees, it's totally different, okay? Because in sycamore trees, it continue attacking on the main trunk, you cannot get away by just pruning the branches because it's on the trunk. So that's different, okay?
Okay, how does the host range of these beetles in their introduced range compare to that in their native range?
That's a very good point. So we have several visit to where the beetles are from. When we look at the native host range, in Southeast Asia, now we have the different tree species than their native tree species, but they have sycamore trees in south part of the China and also some of the Taiwan and also Vietnam, they are also being infested. So the suitable host and the range is so different. That's why I mentioned that when these kind of, I also forgot to mention that in their native vegetation, they are not causing any damage on those native plants. So when we went to the first time in Taiwan, and then we went to the places, and then we asked our colleagues from that, okay, show us where the polyphagus chateau borer is infested. They said, what are you talking about? So they are not even aware of any damage of this kind of ambrosia beetles. And that's not causing damage on that one. So when they come to the new area, new location such as California, where they can find more suitable reproductive hosts where they can colonize and then cause more damage than anywhere else. That's why the earlier I said that even beetle doesn't know how much damage that they could cause in a new area because there are different environment, different host range, they can jump from one to another.
Okay, is the preference for marginal areas to canker true of other tree species as well?
Most of them is the true, yes. I will say most of the trees, they prefer the margin of the canker areas. We have also been working with the several other the controlled environment, and then we have learned a lot that when you control or remove those vulnerable, most suitable part of the plant, which is all pruning wound with the infested PSHP, with the canker pathogen, you can reduce population way, way down. You can actually control it. So that's why we are coming up with the integrated pest management practices, not only the try to control the beetle, but also making the environment less suitable or host less suitable for the beetle. That's the important. Yes, the short answer is yes.
Okay, have you found Rafaela species in your investigations?
No, we don't have any Rafaela. Okay, when you say the Rafaela species, it's different. Rafaela species is another complex too. When you are, if you are asking me if we have found Rafaela laricola, which is the fungal species, which is most aggressive pathogen in East Coast, we haven't found that one in California yet. I believe it was the latest found in the close to Texas area, in South, like the eastern part of the United States. But as I mentioned that if you are asking other Rafaela species, which are not that much pathogen, yes, we found another Rafaela species, which is Rafaela montetii, that's associated with another ambrosia beetle that we found in Valley Oak in northern part of the California. So that's different beetle, different fungi, different aggressiveness of the pathogenicity. But if the short answer is, we haven't found any laurel wilt, either ambrosia beetle or also pathogen in California.
Okay, I think you touched on this earlier, but I'll read this one. Earlier in the presentation, you said when the beetle looks for a host, they search for healthy, vigorous trees, but this data suggests that they prefer to infest the margins of a canker, which is more likely to be infested.
Okay, that's a very good point. So what I meant with that is that they're comparing with the bark beetle. Okay, I don't know if you are familiar with the bark beetle. Bark beetles are the one that usually colonizes on the bark, which is phloem, part of the plant. Bark beetles are able to detect their host based on the ethanol that the stress plant is produced. At that time, bark beetles know that that host is compromised and they can colonize easily and then they produce. For example, former bark canker, Western oak bark beetle, which is a very common problem on coast live oak. But these beetles and their fungi can only colonize and attack on water-stressed or drought-stressed coast live oaks. When you have one coast live oak stressed with the water, one coast live oak next to it is well irrigated, they don't go to the healthy one, well irrigated one. That's different. When it comes to these beetles, they are not detecting their host based on the ethanol that their host produce. They detect their host based on the fungal volatile that they are carrying from their mouth. What I meant with that is that when they attacked their host in the sycamore kind of cases, it is not necessarily they are localized colonizing on the canker margin. As I showed you, my first slide is that in a very good healthy sycamore tree trunk, there is no canker, they can colonize. Okay? Let me rephrase it. Yes, not only on avocado, but other tree species, they prefer canker margin, one. The second one is that in some host species, such as sycamore, the box elder, willow, they are not necessarily looking for the canker margin. They can also attack on the trunk of the plant without any canker. But when it comes to avocado, they cannot colonize on the main trunk somehow. We are gonna find that soon. They can only count the canker part. It's a little bit complicated, but I hope I was able to answer your question.
Okay, in the case of high density for avocado, do the shot hole borers colonize young branches unlike the normal case you described for avocado?
Okay.
And if so, why?
Very good point. Okay, in high density planting that I'm gonna give you an example of the avocado orchard in Azusa, which is the northern part of the Los Angeles County that we have been experiencing. I think it is the compromisation of the two things. First, when you have the high density planting, lower level of the branches are having less light. Therefore, they are becoming more vulnerable for the canker pathogen or they are dying because of the lack of light. Therefore, probably beetle is finding most suitable location in that area and they colonize and finish the branches in that area. I think that is what's happening. Because in healthy vigor, young branches, they don't colonize. We have evidence of that. We have data for that. But only that happened in the high density planting. I think that explains that some of the branches are dying from the shading.
Okay. Is the state taking any actions to prevent movement of the shot hole borer further north, assuming that it can survive further north?
Okay, so I didn't have a time to mention on that one. Yes, the CDFA has been organizing a group of the researcher, not only researcher, also other commodities, including Forest Service, CAL FIRE, and other the land managers in California. And then we recently received now about like the $5 million of funding to continue doing research, not only me, there are several the researchers who has been working on not only from the pathogen part, but also beetle, and there are some also working on the removal of the infested plants and everything. So the state of California has been organizing that one. And then recently they have published a report that gives you more information what they have done so far. So at this point, yes, they are collaborating with the researchers and other commodities as well. Yes.
Okay, are there any preventative options or only curative?
All the things that I mentioned, you know, the preventative. So the curative options are very difficult. Why? When you are dealing with a mosquito, mosquito is the one that flies around. You have to spray a pesticide. It has to have the contact effect and then kill the flies. But when it comes to chateau borer or ambrosia beetles, they colonize, make the galleries in the wood tissue, which is 3 to 4 inch deep in the wood tissues, very, very secure and safe. Whatever you apply from outside, they are not gonna be able to diffuse into that area. They are safe from the pesticide. So there's no curative options of that. We have been doing a lot of research, which we found several chemicals that could be applied on some of the landscape, which are expensive, not as effective as other pesticides. We have several publications that have been published. If you are willing to know more about it, I can send you by email. Please send me an email, or you can find that copy of it from my lab website as a published papers. So again, most of it is the preventative. For curative is very difficult. So another option that we are also looking for is that with my colleagues, Richard Stadthammer, entomologist from UC Riverside, is that we are trying to find out if we can bring any natural enemies. And several trips that we have done in Southeast Asia, we were able to find a wasp, a very small wasp, that is able to control the beetle, attack the female beetle, and then kill it. So I believe one of the Stadthammer students has been focusing on working on that one. For this kind of predator, kind of the natural enemies, are not a long-term, not a short-term studies that you can find and then release. It's a long-term solution and studies. I believe they have been doing good progress on that one. So if you want to know more about it, please feel free to send email to Dr. Richard Stadthammer. I'm sure he will be able to answer your question in detail.
Okay, should the infested branches that are pruned out be burned, or is chipping good enough?
Okay, very good point. If you are resident in California, you cannot burn. So that requires to get permission. Please don't start fire in California. It's very important in California, okay? And then the burning is not. So as I mentioned to you that the chipping is enough. If you are not moving the infested chipping material to somewhere else, okay? Just chip it. When you chip it in the certain size, you don't even need to worry about the solarization. Just chipping and spreading on the area is enough, okay?
Okay, does the beetle have a peak flight period or emergence?
Yes, I didn't have time to show you this information. So the beetle seems to be having two peaks in the year around, during the year, one in the spring, one in the fall. If you want, I can give you more information about it by email. Okay, yes, there are peak times. Well, but they also found out that the beetle is active year around within the tree, but the flight times are two times during the year.
Okay, in the past, I was told that pesticides could not be used because the fruit would be poisoned. Is the serenade ASO safe to use?
Okay, yes. For example, there are no pesticides that is registered to use on avocado. The serenade is registered because you are not applying this serenade on the fruit. Even though serenade is registered to use on the spray on the plants. As long as you follow the label rules, which is certain time before the harvest, you cannot apply, which is not the case because we are focusing on just spraying on the pruning wound area. You don't even need the spray or apply entire plant or entire orchard, which is expensive. It is not necessary because you are just focusing on pruning wounds. Okay.
Okay. It looks like we're down to one comment and one question. So the question, was there not an association made between high soil and water nitrogen levels and infestation?
We haven't done any studies on that one, high nitrogen level, but I can give you my thoughts about it. In a general rule of thumb, when you give more fertilizer and more water to your plants, plants speed up their growth. When they are speeding up, they produce cell quicker than usual. When the plant produce cell in a short time, they have the weaker cell wall than other plants. Therefore, there are also more space between the cell than another place because plant is growing so fast. That makes your plant vulnerable, not only this kind of pathogen, but other pathogen as well. So over irrigation, over fertilization is not recommended in any case, not only for this one. So I imagine that. Because when you look at how the pathogen colonizes the food pieces is that the pathogen colonizes and then they have to pass through the cell wall in each cell. Each cell has cell wall, based on the cellulase. If that cell wall is thick enough, if the plant is healthy, growing vigorously normally, it's gonna take more time for fungus to go through that cell. If you give too much other items that make those cell wall weaker, then your plant is gonna be weaker for pathogen to colonize. That's the rule of thumb. We haven't done any studies. There are some observations, monitoring that has been done that show some kind of the studies, but we haven't done any the scientific study on that one.
Okay. And this is just a comment. So to prevent bugs increasing populations, we are using electric mosquito killer lamps at night in the summer season. It has helped us to reduce the attacks.
Attack of polyphagus at all war? I don't know if that will work. So that's not area of my expertise. That's the question that could be answered by the entomologists. But top of my head, I haven't seen. I don't know if these ambrosia beetles are flying during the night. We have no idea, which doesn't make sense for them to fly during the night, which could be a risk for them to find suitable host and which will risk their life. I would thought about it. And so I'm a little bit not sure about that comment. Okay. That's not my area that I can answer.
Okay, and I think that is all of them. So thank you everybody for hanging in there. We've had a really good Q&A session, and thank you, Akif, for presenting today.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for your attention and contribution. Thank you.